Hi, welcome to my latest video. Lately, I've been doing quite a few short, simple videos on my Freelander 2. I've shown videos looking at parts that I've developed. I've also looked at wiper blades, rear high-level brake light, and various other easy, simple things that I've done to my car. I think it's about time that I do one of my long, complicated videos. So, what am I going to be doing today? This is a big project. I'm going to be fitting a winch to my Freelander 2. Here is the winch. It's a Rhino 13,500-pound synthetic rope winch. Let's have a quick look in the box. There it is. And I'm going to be fitting that behind the grille on my car. So it's a discreet hidden winch mounted out of sight with a fair lead, which is the thing that the rope comes through, where the number plate is, and there'll be a bit of rope with a hook which can be hooked onto the towing eye, and that's all you'll see from outside. Behind the scenes, I need some kind of mounting tray to replace the factory crossmember, and the winch will then mount onto that. There's a lot of things that I need to have a think about. The wiring, the cabling that goes to the winch, goes through this solenoid box here. That will need relocating because as standard it usually sits on top of the winch. There won't be enough room to do it like that. So I need to have a think about that. I also need to have a think about this handle here. This is the spool release handle. I won't be able to get to that, so I need to come up with a way of motorizing that. Just rescue my Rhino stickers that they've given me. Put that back in there. Okay. So what I'm going to do is split this video down into several parts, okay? So there'll be at least two videos, possibly three. In the first video, I'm going to remove the front end of the car. I'm going to remove the factory crossmember. And then I'm going to fit the winch mount with the winch, put the front end back on with a new hole for the rope to come through, and fit the fair lead. And then in the second video, I'm going to actually connect it up. I'll show the connecting up of the solenoid, where I locate that, and I'll also look at possible ways of motorizing this spool handle here. So that handle is a sort of like a 90 degree handle. It seems to go 180 degrees. I'll have to look at that actually. I think it's literally a 90 degree on or off. So ideas that I've had is to use this, which is a sort of a 12 volt 90 degree central heating valve. It's like a motorized valve thing. The valve, the actual bit of pipe, can be taken off so that we end up with something that turns 90 degrees when you connect the different wires. That could be then connected on top somehow, bolted on top instead of that handle, so it then operates the spool using some buttons or switches. Alternatively, I could use one of these, which is a linear actuator with some kind of crank mechanism to sort of rotate the handle. I may try to actually put that onto a remote control. So I've bought this little device here, which allows you to actually connect up a motor, and it will turn the motor one way or the other depending on which button you press on here. Sort of a lock or unlock button for engaging the clutch or allowing the rope to free spool out. I'll also look at fair leads. Okay, so this type is the sort of traditional roller fair lead. Now this is used on cars that have winches with a cable instead of a rope. A lot of people say you mustn't use these with a rope, because the rope can get a bit pinched and may get damaged by the edge of these rollers. I've also read on the web that some people have used these with rope and it's been absolutely fine. The alternative to this is what's called the hawse fair lead, which will no doubt be in the bottom of this box somewhere, which is really just a hole with a sort of metal surround. So which is better? Rope rubbing against metal with friction, possibly getting hot, or rollers which spin nicely but may pinch the rope. I'll have a look at pros and cons of both. Okay. And then in a third video, I could actually go out and do a bit of off-roading and actually use the winch to pull myself out of some mud and see if it actually works. So in a moment I will unbox this and pull everything out, and we can put the winch up on the bench here, have a proper look at it and a proper look at what else we get with the winch in the box. And some of you may remember that a year ago I did a winch unboxing teaser trailer to celebrate my YouTube channel reaching 2,000 subscribers. Well, we're now at nearly 4,000 subscribers and I still haven't fitted this winch. It's sat in storage for nearly a year now. Why haven't I fitted it? Well, it's a combination of me being very busy with other projects and also a lot of difficulty getting hold of a winch mounting tray to put this winch on. There is only one company in the UK who make the mounting tray for the Freelander 2, and that's Muddy Mods. Whenever they get any in stock, they sell out very, very quickly. I kept checking their website to see if they had any in, and then finally, after about a year of waiting, I managed to get hold of one. And here it is. The Muddy Mods winch mounting tray. Not cheap, but it's the only way of fitting a winch to a Freelander 2, apart from trying to make one of these yourself. I did actually look at enrolling on a welding evening class course at my local technical college, but unfortunately that was fully subscribed. So in the end, I spent the money and I bought the Muddy Mods winch mount tray. This is very well made. It's made of thick steel, seam welded here. It comes with a kit of nuts and bolts, nice big heavy gauge bolts here, and spacer pieces. I think those go between here and the front bumper and the fair lead. So that's it. There it is. That's what I'm going to fit behind my grill in place of the factory crossmember. So what I'm going to do now is get the car up on ramps, take the front bumper off and have a look at the factory crossmember that needs to be removed. You can do this without putting the car on ramps, but I'm going to do that just to make access a little bit easier, just to raise everything up so that I'm not bending over to do all this work. Okay, so I've taken the winch out of the box and I've discovered something interesting. This free spool lever here just spins round and round. Okay, so it isn't actually the 90 degree action, or even the 180 degree action, that frees this up so you can just pull the rope out. It's purely the lift, okay? So when you turn it, you have to lift it slightly. So that's lifted, and that actually can run now. But then when you turn it back in either direction like that, it clicks downwards and that then locks it. If I just lift that very slightly, that's now free. Okay, so it's not actually going to need something that rotates. It's just going to need something that lifts. So maybe that linear actuator will actually be able to do that. Or I can do something where it rotates and lifts at the same time. I don't know yet, but that will be something for the second video. Okay, so for now, I'm going to look at just getting this fitted. Worst case, I actually pull the rope out with the motor unwinding. Okay, the free spool is just a nice feature because it means that if you're stuck in mud and you need to pull the rope out to a tree that's 10 meters away, you haven't got to sit there slowly unwinding it using the battery or drawing current from the alternator. You can just pull the rope out. Okay, that's called free spooling. So it actually says here, free spool. These drawings on here are a bit confusing. I don't know what this is showing here. I don't know if that is a hand. I think that's a hand lifting it. And then it says free spool that way. No, I think that arrow there is for pulling out the rope. Okay. And then engaged to wind the rope back in, but it doesn't actually show what you have to do. So there's some instructions here to disengage clutch, move shifter tab to the free spool position. It doesn't actually say what the free spool position is. I mean, the free spool position actually is that lifted slightly against the spring. Do not run a winch excessively in reverse to pay out wire rope. This causes unnecessary heating of the brake. Okay, so what they're saying there is you should avoid running the winch out on the motor. Okay, so you do want to be able to use this really rather than actually winding it out as well as in. Okay, well that's fine. I intend to get that working somehow. Not sure how. I have seen people actually fabricate some kind of lever, like a rod that sticks out through the grill that they then push or stick some kind of lever in and turn that. That doesn't look good to me. I want to really be able to just press a button, or even better, zap it with a remote control and have it just change free spool or engaged. I think that would be a much, much better way of doing things. What else have we got in the box here? So we have some stickers here, which I won't be sticking onto my car, but I can put them on my toolbox or something. We've got a remote control. Right, out, in. Okay, that's nice. That's nice. And it's a wired remote now. That's interesting. There's a socket, a plug there. I guess that plugs into this, which is the solenoid. Aha, there we go. There's a kind of a socket on the side there. Right, okay, this, which is some kind of bag. It's like a waterproof bag. It's kind of made out of the same sort of stuff that wetsuits are made out of. So that's some sort of bag or cover. Maybe it's a cover to go over the winch if you do mount this onto sort of like a defender or something where it's actually sticking out the front and is fully visible. I'm not going to be doing it that way on this car. I just think it would look a bit crazy with the winch sitting even further out than the already slightly kind of curved front. There are safety considerations there as well. It would injure somebody if I bumped them with it, or they walked into it, or I bumped into the back of another car. That would cause a lot of damage. So I won't be mounting the winch sticking out. Now, this is the fairlead. So this is a hawse type fairlead, H-A-W-S-E. And now, which way round does that? Well, that must surely go with the Rhino logo pointing outwards, but the warning label is on the back, which is not very sensible, because when that's fitted on the car, you won't see it. So, okay, that's the fairlead. Let's pop that somewhere up here. Okay, we'll compare the different fairleads later on. So what else do we have in here? We've got some more cable, nice thick sort of earth strap there, and more remote controls. Two more remote controls. Okay, so this is interesting. These are wireless. Don't think they've got any batteries in them. So wireless remote controls, two of them. I don't know why you would need two. And a wired one. Three different controllers. So I have heard that these wireless ones aren't very good. Not necessarily the Rhino ones, but just in general. A lot of winches do come with these wireless remotes, and I have heard that they're not very reliable. So what is this? This is some sort of it's like a lanyard thing. That must be for the remote control. Okay, so that's a good idea. So you could put it around your neck so you don't lose it. Okay, don't think I'll be doing that. Yes, okay. Or maybe hang it up somewhere in the car. Now we have a nice hook here. Look at that, that looks good. It's got one of these little safety catch things there. And a bit of material on it. I think that's maybe for you to hold to pull it out. Don't know. I think this winch did come with some instructions. I don't know where they are. It was a year ago that I bought it, so I probably did take them out and have a look through, and then promptly lost them. So okay, so there's a hook there. I don't think I will keep this bit of orange fabric on here. If anybody watching this video knows what that is for, then let me know, because I think that's gonna get in the way, because the idea is really that we have the rope coming out here, and then that will just hook when it's not in use. It will hook onto my recovery towing eye. So I don't really want this piece of fabric dangling under the car. So, okay, that's the hook, and lots of bolts and things. Now, I'm guessing these are bolts to not only attach the winch to a tray. These holes here are the holes that the winch goes on. Now, I've been reliably assured that these are a standard pattern. I don't know how true that is, but I have heard of someone else fitting this exact model of winch to the Muddy Mods tray, and it went straight on. Muddy Mods also provide the option of buying the tray with a Winch Max. I think it's either a Winch Max or a Bear Mac winch. I don't know which one it is. I think it's Winch Max. And there are other makes of winch available, like Warn, and various other brands, and apparently they use a standard bolt pattern. I don't know how true that is. Yes, if you have tried to fit a winch and you found the bolts didn't line up, then leave a comment below and let me know. It would be useful for other people, other viewers who are thinking of doing this project to their Freelander 2s, to know what fits and what doesn't. So we've got some bolts there. Some of those are possibly for attaching that, although these all look like big. We've got M10, what have we got there? Four M10, and then what looks like two lighter duty M8s, which are probably for this. Okay, there's some holes on the back, but those are quite small. Those are very small. Those are like M6, M5. What's this here? Here we go. Right, another pack with some small bolts in. Okay, so these small machine screws here will be for attaching the solenoid box. Okay, and there is some sort of metal bracket here. I've no idea how that fits, although I don't intend to put the solenoid box on top. So let's just pull this out and have a look. So we have red and black cables going in, red and black cables coming out. This is basically a switch. It's an electrically controlled switch, or well, remote controlled switch, actually, using the remote controls. So we connect one red and black to the battery, probably the longer red, I would have thought. Does it actually have any markings here? No, it doesn't. Okay, all right, I'll have to double check the wiring, make sure I get that the right way round, but it's almost certainly the long red goes to the positive of the battery. That will go to the body of the car. Okay, so that's an earth. So either the body of the car or the engine or some sort of ground point. Okay, ideally, really, all the way back to the negative terminal on the battery, but that's not really long enough. So I might have to do something there to make that reach if I do decide to take it all the way to the battery. I'm not sure why that's got a yellow and that one's got a black. I wonder if the yellow is maybe to the winch. I don't know. I'll need to dig the instructions out and have a look. And another short red, which almost certainly will go to the winch too. So, don't know what this is. What have we got here? Some kind of some sort of little tiny earth connection wire. This is very, very small low current wire. That might possibly be to just sort of ground out for radio interference reasons or something like that. I'm not sure. I will need to look at the instructions and see what that one's for. And then on the side here we have our socket there. Now this is an interesting one. If this is hidden behind the grill, I'm not going to be able to reach that to plug in the remote control. So I either need to use the wireless remote controls, or better still, extend that out. And I think that is what they call an XLR connector there. It looks a bit like an XLR. Extend that out to a panel mounting socket. Now maybe we can put a socket on the slam panel under here, so that if I get stuck, I just pop the bonnet and then plug in the remote. Very important is that when operating the remote, you're sort of stood well to the side in case something does snap. Now this is a rope winch, not a wire winch. Okay, so it's a lot safer. A wire winch not only is quite dangerous, but it's also very heavy. Okay, so the weight is something to consider. This winch weighs a lot. This box is 25 to 30 kilos. So when all of this is fitted to the car, that's extra weight on the front. But if I'd gone for the wire winch, they do a wire option, wire cable, that will weigh a lot more. Okay, that'll be steel cable weighing a lot. So I've deliberately gone for the rope because it's safer and it's lighter weight. But winching is still dangerous, even with a rope. So when winching, I need to make sure that there's enough cable on this remote to allow me to stand well clear. And it looks like that actually comes with quite a lot of cable on that. I don't know how long that is, but at some point I'll take that cable tie off there and we'll unfold that and see how long it is. So that is it. Well, there is our extra long earth strap, actually, which might be useful for Maybe that goes to the bodywork and that then goes to the battery or something like that. So that, I'll remember that that's in there. Okay, right, time to get the car up on ramps now and get on with this. Okay, so I've put the car up on ramps. That should make it a little bit easier to undo the screws underneath the front bumper. I don't think I'll need to remove my sump guard, but we'll see. If I do need to remove that, then it's a lot easier to get in underneath and undo the big bolts that attach that. So the plan is to remove the headlight guards, remove the headlights themselves, and then undo all of the bolts and screws that attach the front bumper. Okay, so there are some bolts here, there are some screws underneath, and there are some quite difficult bolts to get at in here. So I'll have to partially remove the wheel arch liner, certainly the front section of that, to get up and undo the bolts. Okay, so I will do that now, and then we'll look at what's behind here. Front end off. That was quite a game getting that off. It took quite a lot of time. This connector here was particularly difficult to get apart. I pushed that red thing back and it just wouldn't come apart. You can stick a little tiny screwdriver up the side to try and ease it out, but I found that pressing in there, in that little red bit in there, actually that was like a sort of a barb stopping it coming apart. So I pressed in there and it then came apart a bit easier. When I put this back together, I'm going to smear some grease around it to make that easier to remove in the future. And then over here you have to loop the washer hose back round to stop all the fluid coming out, but whilst doing that, don't dislodge the pump like I did. I've dumped an entire 5 litres of washer fluid all over the ground, so I've got to try and get that fitted back in somehow. So I'm going to have to look up from underneath. Okay, there we go. Front end removed. This is the crossmember, the factory crossmember that I'm going to be removing. Okay, so there's a load of big nuts, 4 big nuts on each side. So once I remove this crossmember, you should be able to see a little bit clearly how the winch is fitted on. Okay, so I'm now going to undo the nuts that are holding the crossmember on. For that, I'm going to use a deep 17mm socket, a 1/2-inch ratchet. Might need an extension bar. Okay, I think they're nylock nuts actually. That actually wasn't very tight at all. To expect them to be really tight. Okay, right, I shall undo the rest of those and then we'll remove the crossmember from the car.
is the last one. Now, one thing I've noticed is there's a wire here, which is attached to the front, goes down to the front, and that is feeding the factory horns, which are actually mounted inside this crossmember. It's not actually a complete square section, it's more of a sort of C shape. And I've tried to remove that plug there. I've actually cut the wire in the end because I don't use these factory horns. They're not powered. I've got air horns up here now. So I've removed the relay and I've got my own relay driving the air horns. So there's no power coming down this wire. So what I'll do is, seeing as the horns are going to come away with the crossmember and I don't need them, I'll just cut the wire and then I'll make that safe. But if you don't have air horns, you will need to find a way to disconnect the factory horns and then refit them after removing the crossmember. Okay, don't know where you can put them, might be able to put them on the winch tray, but you'll need to deal with this wiring. Be aware that the horn can be used even with the key out of the ignition, so whilst that wire is not permanently live, it can easily become live. So if you do end up disconnecting it or cutting it, just make sure that you make the ends safe so they're not going to short out. Okay, so I'm going to remove the last nut from here and then carefully lift away this cross member. It is going to be heavy. Right, there it is. It's not as heavy as I thought it was going to be. It is made of steel, but it's quite hollow, so it's not too heavy. There are the horns embedded into the crossmember. So somehow you will need to disconnect those and remove them. So what I'll do now is I'll lay this down and I'll actually have a look at those connectors and see how they disconnect. I've just cut the wire here, so I'll insulate that up and just tuck that out of the way. So this is what we're left with, a big kind of hole. Luckily not rusty in there, but before I cover that back up, I'll give it a good spray with some oil just to keep any rust at bay that might decide to form in there. There is actually, I think, I thought there was a gasket. There might even be a gasket. No, there's no gasket. I thought there was a gasket on one of the pieces of metal, but there isn't. So, it's just a hollow. It's just all part of the crumple zone crash protection type of engineering on the chassis. Good news is these nuts all came away pretty easily. I don't know if I need to reuse those nuts. I think the winch tray comes with new nuts, but we'll see. So I thought I'd just lay the crossmember down and have a look at the factory horns. Okay, so you can see there are two of them on a metal bracket mounted by what appears to be one M10 bolt, or 10mm head bolt rather. It's probably an M5 or an M6. So these two connectors, that bracket is pretty weak actually, you can just bend it out. See how you disconnect these. sure. I think you're better off actually probably removing this. What I'll do is I'll just undo that, if it'll undo, it's pretty rusty. And just want to try and see how these connectors disconnect. There we go, it's that thing. Press that, and there we go. Okay, so the other one, it's on the other side. There we go, easy as that. Okay, so there's quite a few cable ties and things attaching that, but the connectors are actually very easy to remove once you know where to press. So if you're reusing your factory horns, you'll need to remove these from here and remount them somewhere else and then redo the wiring. So I was a bit unsure about this black plastic surround here. It's a bit flimsy and a bit unsightly, and I'd like to get rid of it, but I don't know how important it is for channeling the airflow into the radiator. I have seen some photos of other winch installations, and most of those people removed this. They certainly removed this bottom piece here. One person left this upper piece, but everybody else just removed all of that, and it seemed to work fine. So I'm going to do the same. I'm going to take this off. Pulls apart. There we go. Okay, so pop that over here, and then somehow I can release the rest of it. I'll have to find there's various little clippy bits like this here where you have to sort of press that. There we go. Probably something at the bottom here. I think that might be it's a little popper. Okay, I'll put the phone back on the tripod and then I'll remove that. There we go. That's free now. It's just a sort of an air funneling kind of surround. But I'm going to take my chances and try and manage without that. Let's have a closer look at what we've got now. So this isn't actually the radiator, that's the radiator behind. This is the air conditioning condenser. Okay, it's got quite a lot of dead bugs in it, but there's no actual mud blocking it up. I'm hoping the radiator behind is just as clean. So I might just carefully just give this a little brush down just to remove all the dead flies and wasps and that are stuck in it. This here is the intercooler. Okay, so that's cools down the turbocharged pressurized air from the turbocharger. So it is literally an air-to-air heat exchanger, so the air that enters it has been compressed by the turbocharger, so it would be hot because it's been pressurized. And then it cools down as it goes through and then goes off towards the inlet manifold and the throttle body. Why do we do that? Well, cooler air is denser, so it contains more oxygen molecules per cubic litre of air. More oxygen means more power, so it's quite a good idea to have an intercooler. Okay, so these wires are for my strobes. This wire was for the old factory horn. I may just take these through and take them out of the way for now. Leaves and things caught up around these between the condenser and the radiator, but I'm sure they'll find their way out eventually. See if I can get one. No, it's too far down. Okay. Now, some people get the pressure washer out and blast this. I don't think I need to do that. There's no mud caught up in it. I've not got any issues with the cooling system or the air conditioning or even the intercooler. So I do believe that they're all flowing air as well as they need to, and they're not clogged up with anything. So right, we'll leave all that as it is. Don't know if this, I don't think these come off. Okay, so that will just have to stay there. Those are the old clips for that surround. Now, one thing that I will show whilst we've got access here is the clearance here between the intercooler hose. Both ends, actually. There's actually a very slight split starting to cut into the hose there. It's not all the way through, but this bodywork here presses against the hose. I don't know if it would do that with a factory hose, but with a blue or uprated silicone replacement hose, this is actually a blue hose, believe it or not, so much dirt on it. It will rub against there. Now, on the other side, I've actually put another Michelor clamp here, just purely as protection to stop the hose cutting through. That's the one that actually attaches the end of the hose. This one is just to put something metal between the hose and the chassis. So I'll add one to this end whilst I can get in here. I might also look at bending this metal very slightly, just this way. But I'm going to see if the winch mount goes on first. I don't want to go and bend that and then find it's fouling the ends of the winch mounting tray. So what I'm going to do now is dig out the end pieces and just do a sort of offering up of the mounting tray to see what it looks like and see if it fits. So what I've done is just carefully offered up these end pieces. Let's put this one in. Okay. It fits. These pieces fit anyway, but it is touching here. Okay, and that's causing it to be quite a tight fit, and all of these studs are hard over against the square holes. Now, looking at the nuts and bolts that came with this, there are 8 of these what appear to be M10 8.8 grades. They're not actually high tensile, but they're just bright galvanized steel bolts. I don't think they're stainless steel. They wouldn't be rated 8.8 if they were stainless. And 8 of these nice serrated flanged nuts. They're not Nylox, they are just normal nuts with a flange and a serrated sort of surface here. These, because there's 8 of them, they could only possibly be for these holes here, 4 there and 4 at the other end. There are then 4 smaller bolts
and nuts. Now, the Muddy Mods winch mount didn't come with any instructions. Okay, so I'm having to kind of figure this out for myself. The four smaller bolts, I believe, are to actually mount the winch itself. Okay, so that takes four smaller bolts up through the four holes in the middle. Because these here are studs, it looks like we need to reuse these nylock nuts. Okay, so these are okay. They're a little bit old and grubby, but they're not rusty. I know nylocks don't like being reused, but don't really get any choice because I haven't got any spares of these. So I shall fit those back on. Before I do that, I'm going to spray a load of oil up in there just to protect against corrosion. And I'll also put some copper grease on these threads here. Now that might actually undo the locking ability of the nylocks, but if I ever do sell the car and I end up taking the winch mount off and putting the factory crossmember back on, I'll be grateful for a little bit of copper grease on those threads to undo the nuts. Okay, so I've just given the area where this will bolt onto a good spray with copper grease. I've also sprayed a load into that hole there just for a bit of extra protection. Try and get this in. It's hitting here. Very tight fit, and risks actually damaging the thread slightly. Right, that's that one. Let's get this one in. Right, there's that one. That seems to fit a little bit better. And now what I'm going to do is carefully offer up the piece in between and see if it fits. A little bit of a loose fit, but I think as those end pieces are tightened up, pull them in. So what I'm going to do now is just put a couple of the nuts back on, just to stop this all falling off and crashing on the floor. That's held loosely in position now. So now what I'm going to do is see if I can get a couple of bolts in for this. Now, I don't know which direction the bolts have to go. I don't know if they have to go in from the end with the nuts inside or pointing outwards. Maybe it doesn't matter. It's probably better if the nuts go on that side, the bolts go that way. The reason for that is it'll leave a little bit more room in this area for the solenoid box, which we'll need to mount next to the winch rather than on top.
this is a bit fiddly doing it on my own, but it's still got to be easier than holding my phone in one hand. That is loosely in position. Now I'm hoping that when these are tightened up, everything will pull nice and straight. Okay, that's everything loosely assembled, and I'm very pleased with the alignment. Everything's going together very well. Some of these bits of metal are a bit different in size, isn't that? But I think it's actually meant to be like that. I don't know. I was expecting this to all line up properly here, but it hasn't. Doesn't matter, so long as everything can be tightened up, it's all hidden from view anyway. So right, okay, so now what I'm going to do is one by one tighten these, and then I'm going to tighten the big nuts at the back, and that will pull everything hard in against the chassis of the car. Okay, so I've tightened everything up. I very carefully tightened all of these nuts and bolts, one by one, gradually increasing the torque on them. So everything is now fully tight, and that's looking really, really good. It's really strong. These gaps have closed up. Any gaps here have closed up. And it's actually fitting really, really well. Very pleased with that. So what I'm going to do now is offer up the winch and just see what it looks like. There we go. That looks amazing. That looks really good. Now I've realised something actually. Those four nuts and bolts there are not to bolt the winch down to the tray. To do that, we use the bolts that came with the winch. Those four nuts and bolts are to go in here, so I'll need to insert them before I bolt the winch down. And that goes into that little cylindrical spacer here and here, so there's a bolt in from that side. Not totally sure where the nuts go. Yeah, that's a strange one actually. But the bolts need to thread into that spacer piece. Let's just find one of those here. think they're quite worried, given nuts. Oh, right. Okay. So that goes there and acts as a buffer between the front bumper and the tray, just to hold everything strong and rigid. So bolts need to go in from behind, but there's nowhere for any nuts to go, so I will use the bolts but not the nuts. So I put these on here using two of the bolts that came with the winch tray kit. The other two I think would go in from this end to bolt the fairlead on from the outside. I would actually prefer if there were washers underneath these bolt heads, only because the holes are quite large and they move around a lot. These ones weren't so bad. I would have still actually liked to have seen washers under here, really, but anyway, these bolts actually fitted in quite nicely into the holes, so I'm happy with those. But these ones here just seem a bit loose, really. So looking at what we get with the winch, so there are four bolts with square nuts on them. Now those square nuts fit in to here. Okay, so what I need to do is sort of carefully offer up the winch with these square nuts sort of pushed into these holes, and then put these bolts up from below with a spring washer and a plain washer. Now, when I looked at this, I thought, oh no, I'm not going to be able to get that up there because of the intercooler. However, there is just enough room, and it is very tight, just enough room to get that into position, luckily. Otherwise I'd have had to remove this all over again. So I need to get those bolts there, put the winch up with its square nuts, tighten all that up. The winch also came with these bigger, these are like M10, short M10 bolts with nuts and a selection of washers. Now I think those are for the fairlead, although I can't use these because they're too big. This thread here is M8, not M10. So I will have to attach the fairlead with those bolts and probably find some M8 stainless washers. Might even opt to use some stainless bolts. Those aren't stainless, those are just bright steel. Now of course the bolts out here outside of the bumper are going to be visible and exposed to the elements and may rust. So I think some stainless bolts with stainless washers from the outside, the bumper going in, and that would do there. Now that means that we've got a couple of spare nuts, bolts and washers. Now the nuts and bolts I don't think I'll be using at all, but these washers here, even though they're a bit big because these are M10s, I'll probably actually stick them underneath here. It'll be a bit big and a bit loose, but at least it's better than nothing. So we could always do that. Doesn't look too bad. It's actually fine. I mean, it's the hole that's too big, really. So, yeah, I think that's good. That's a good use for those spare washers. I won't bother with the... might actually put the spring... Yeah, no, the spring washers aren't really going to work. They will be too big. So I think we'll just run with that like that. I'll have a look in my nuts and bolts organiser and see if I've got some stainless
M8s, but those actually have gone on fine. Actually, they look pretty good. So I'll put the other one under there. Okay, so next thing, get these tightened up, get the winch on with the square nuts, tighten up the bolts from underneath. Okay, so we've got the washers behind these bolts here, and then I've put the square nuts into the four recesses here and loosely screwed in these bolts underneath. The ones at the back were quite difficult. I had to sort of put them in, lower the winch down, and then try to wiggle these bolts until they started to bite in the nuts. They're all loosely in now, so now I'm going to tighten these up. I'll have to get a spanner for the ones at the back, so can't get the ratchet in there. Tighten those up. The winch will then be bolted down and everything will be solid. Right, okay, that is it. The winch is bolted on solid, these are solid, everything else is solid, all tightened up. Just need to get the front end back on. Oh, I need to, before I do that, I need to put the solenoid box in position. Right, let's get that. Right, okay, so this is why I put these bolts this way round. I really hope that nothing's going to foul on those, that won't cause an issue, because if they go this way, then it leaves not a lot of room for the control box here. So how am I going to fit this? What I have to remember is I need to put the remote control on here. I either will have to have the remote control permanently connected or use the wireless ones. Or if this is an XLR connector, which I don't know if it is or not, then I might be able to extend that out to a socket somewhere else, up in the engine bay, up on the slam panel maybe. Just have an extension lead to another three pin panel.
panel mounted socket, which I can then plug the remote into. So let's have a little look. This is going to be difficult. This is going to be difficult because that hole there, I think, is some kind of drainage hole. I don't think that is for the remote control. So, yeah, we'll have to have a bit of a play with this, I think, and see how we can get this to get in. I've seen other people fit it that way round. Pretty sure it was that way round. Raise up slightly. See if it can fit like that, then there's still room here for the remote control to connect on. I've also been looking at the instructions and I've figured out how to connect this up now. So there is a red, a yellow and a black, which all three go to the terminals on the winch. That long red goes to the battery. And then there is a separate long black earth strap which goes from the winch negative to the battery negative. These aren't going to be long enough. The terminals are down here, there are three of them. So because the motor has to turn in both directions, I think it has a sort of a ground and then a positive on one or the other, depending on which way the motor turns. So that's sort of what we've got here. We've got a red and a black, but then this yellow as well. Yes, you can just about see down there. I don't know if you can see that. That terminal there has got some yellow plastic around it. And then this one's got black, and that one there has got red. Right where it meets the body of the winch. Okay. So either I have to extend these, or this needs to mount over here. Also this little tiny ground cable there, I think that's just to equalise up the earths between this and the winch. It's not a high current connection, it's probably for radio interference suppression and that kind of thing. So will that go there? Not really. That's going to block a little airflow through the radiator. I need to be very mindful of the amount that the airflow is being reduced. So putting that one like that is one option. Alternatively, this could locate completely far away, somewhere in the engine bay, and then have longer cables coming out. Right. Okay. I think this we'll have to wait for part two of this video series, because I need to have a bit of a think about that. Right, I'm going to pack up for today and carry on tomorrow morning. This is all bolted in. I just need to work out the wiring.
isn't really enough room to fit this at that end. It could possibly just about go there. That is a very tight fit. I think the headlight is probably going to interfere with that. So I'm not keen on that. I'm also not keen on putting it there because it's just going to block too much airflow through the radiator. This can't really fit that way. There's just not enough room to get it in. So that only then leaves me with two options. One is to relocate it completely somewhere else in the engine bay, which I don't really want to do. And the other option is to put it here, where there's lots of room. It can quite happily sit there and it's not blocking the airflow. Might have a bit of difficulty getting the remote control connected. If I can get it connected, it would have to be sort of left connected and just tied up somewhere in the engine bay, or I can use the wireless remote controls. The biggest problem with putting this here is these wires are not long enough to reach over here. So what I'm going to do is see if I can get hold of some longer cable. Should be able to get cable like this in Halfords. It's just a car battery cable. And I'll have to open this up and replace some of the cables, probably three of them. Yeah, three, one red and two black, with longer ones that can then come along down onto these terminals. This red one here should be long enough to get to the battery. I'll have to cut these clips off and just make sure that is definitely long enough as well. Now, I've seen a couple of other people fit this model of winch and similar winches, and all of them have put their control box here and then either extended the cables, or they were lucky enough to buy a winch that had longer cables, or the terminals were up the other end or whatever. But that is where people seem to fit it, either there, or some people do fit it on top of here. That is going to disrupt the airflow, and it's also going to be very tight with clearance because the front grille comes up at an angle like that. Okay, so anything here needs to be really hard up against the radiator. I just don't think there's enough room for this to go up there. So that's where it's going to go. That is where it's going to go. Either that way up, or possibly like that, maybe a bit further up. The problem then is the remote control connection is underneath, which isn't ideal. So I think probably that way up. It's neat and tidy like that, and all the wiring can then go off to where it needs to go. Okay, that's it for today. Tomorrow I will look at getting longer cables. I will take the number plate off, make a hole in the front end, put the fair lead on the outside, pull this through the hole, attach the hook, tie that up underneath, and perhaps I'll see if I can actually get this to run. It would be good to know if it even actually works or not. So maybe I can use some jump leads or something to connect it up and just see if it actually turns. Right, okay, until tomorrow. We'll be right back. fired this up correctly, there's going to be a bang and a lot of smoke. Okay, ready?